Surgeries, and she had some complications today, so we're not so much doing it on the fly. We kind of have an idea what we're doing. We've been doing this for a long time, but bear with us as we get our bearings. He's usually a little bit better at this type of scenario than we are. My name is Claudia Castro. I'm the managing director of Smart Growth-Forsyth. I've been with the organization for the last, I want to say, almost 10 years. You may not always hear about us, but we're always out there lurking somewhere, listening, paying attention. It's the key operative words, paying attention. Can someone tell me how many counties there are in the United States? A rough guesstimate, how many counties are there in the entire United States?
5,000.
Close, a little bit less.
I was 52 in California and 159 in Georgia.
Yeah, there you go. It's about between 3,500 and 3,700 counties. Forsyth County is the seventh fastest growing county in the nation out of 3,500 plus. So that gives you an idea of what it is that we as a county are going through, what we as a population here are going through, if we are already at that level. Does anyone know where we rank in terms of school districts and how fast we're growing in terms of the country? I think it was third was something that I saw, but we're definitely in the top five, and I'm sure there are plenty more school districts than there are counties in the nation. So top seven in growth, top three in school district growth, 1 + 1 = 175,000 plus, right? Population and growing. Issues related to growth and development are not secondary to what this type of, what candidates who are running for commissioner should be asked. These are primary issues. These are pertinent issues. They're important issues because they involve and they affect all of us as taxpayers, all of us as residents, all of us who are looking for a certain quality of life. So we pride ourselves at Smart Growth on presenting to you a forum or a series of question and answers that's nonpartisan. We're a nonpartisan organization. So these questions that we're asking are not related to politics, they're not related to the GOP political line, they're not related to the Democrat political line or Libertarian or Tea Party. These are questions only related to growth and development in the county and how can we come together and how can we ask our commissioners, what can we ask of them to help formulate the vision that we need to see from them? You know, Todd Levent wants to represent us in District 3 in the seventh fastest growing county in the country. So what does he have to do? What do you want him to do? What does he need to be doing? There's five of them on the board. What vision do they have for where we're going to be, not 2 years from now or 4 years from now, but 20 years from now? Is this going to be the county your children want to come back to? Is this going to be the place where you're going to stay because you're just loving life and everything is going the way you envisioned your dream, American dream would go? Well, these are questions they have to answer. They have to answer, what are they going to do about infrastructure? What are they going to do about schools? What are they going to do about our public safety? These are all related to growth. So as much as they have other issues on their plate when they're talking to maybe a political group, here what they're talking about and what they have to talk about is what methods can they put into place in order to allow growth to occur in the county in an intelligent, in a smart, in a manner that's fitting of the residents that live here, right? We all know what could happen. It's just next door in Gwinnett County. We know what we could look like, and nobody came here for it to look like that. So with that, I'm going to open up the floor to Todd. I will also like to preface, as it comes to mind, I'm sorry, it was a long day at work, that we did ask the other candidate for District 3 Commissioner, David Hole, to attend. We invited him to attend, and we sent him the same questions that we sent to Todd Levent. And we heard back late last week from Mr. Hole that he had another commitment. So he won't be making it today. We did suggest to him and encourage him to please send us his responses to the questions, which were also made public and are on our website, so everything's on the up and up. We asked him to submit answers to the questions so that we could perhaps read a few of them to you and give you his perspective, but we didn't hear back from him. So I just want to let you know where we stand on that. And I'm going to open the floor now to Todd to give his opening statements. And then myself, Bill Startt, who's the Deputy Director of Smart Growth, Dee Rudecci, where'd he go, who's the Treasurer, and Jack Gleason, who's the Environmental Compliance Officer for Smart Growth. They'll all be asking questions from the same playbook that we've posted online and that we've submitted to the candidates. If you've signed in and received a little raffle ticket, that's for you for the end of the evening. We'll call some names out of that. We'll call the numbers out of a.
Did everybody get one that wanted one?
These are an opportunity for you to answer, to ask a question of your candidate. So what we'll do is we'll call a number, and if that's your number and you feel like you have a question that you'd like to ask and you haven't addressed it, then please feel free to stand up at the end of the evening and ask a question. If you haven't yet signed in, we would also ask for you to please sign in so that we have a record of your attendance this evening. Your name, an email contact, what neighborhood you live in, just so we kind of know who has reached in our attempts to reach out to the community. So with that, I open up the Meet the Candidates. Levent, current district three commissioner.
Thank you all, and everybody that doesn't know who I am or never met me before, my name is Todd Levent. I am your current district three commissioner. I want to thank all of you for allowing me to be here tonight. Ms. Claudia, thank you for inviting me. It's been an honor to serve the last 3 years and 4 months. I have to tell you, it takes a lot away from my family and our free time and my friends, but it's really been an honor. And for me, it's been very rewarding and successful. A lot of the accomplishments that we have made that have been really good for our community. In 2010, I promised you I would not vote for millage rate increase. And I am proud to say today, I have not voted one to this point in time, and I do not plan on voting one for the future. That is based on how you plan the growth, as Claudia just described. If you have proper planning, there's no need to raise your millage rate. All of it relates back to growth and how you grow and the value of homes that you plan in your community. We lead the region right now in economic development. We know that. We're the fastest growing county in the state and fifth in the country. Did you say seventh? It went from 13 to seventh, and now they're talking maybe faster, which is a bit scary. It puts huge challenges on your leaders that have to plan for the future. It's very much of a struggle sometimes to look at your infrastructure. And the growth that we have today is from subdivisions that were zoned from back in the 1990s through 2009, which includes Venable Hall, which has more recently been changed for traditions, that has been downsized tremendously, which I'm sure we'll touch on before the meeting's over. We now have one of the lowest unemployment rates in North Georgia at 5% and dropping. That's a good thing. You do need growth for your unemployment rate to go down, but you got to manage it so it doesn't get out of control. You lose control of your future and infrastructure and quality of your life. One of the lowest millage rates in the metro Atlanta area, we do enjoy that. The county's reserve has grown double or so since I've been in office. That's tremendous. That's given us a AAA bond rate. That's given us stable from Moody's. That's allowed us to re-bond and redo bonds to the tune that we save over $20 million in their interest rates. These are bonds that have been in place for years past, and it just helps us get them paid down quicker. Those are all water sewer bonds. We built a beautiful new library at Post Road. It's something our district has been waiting for over 10 years to see. We finally got ours. It is gorgeous. It's the most state-of-the-art library in the state. And it's paid for already. I have voted more than once to try to maintain certain roads that don't need widening to huge roads like Castleberry Road as a two-lane with a turn lane to save millions of dollars. I unfortunately lost a vote recently, and it's now slated to be a four-lane road with a turn lane, which unfortunately spends millions of dollars that would be nice to use on other roads that are rated F, like Old Atlanta Road. That won't happen now. However, we also were fortunate enough to get enough votes to get Mullinax widened to a four-lane road, which does need it, and if anybody travels that thing in the morning hours, you feel the pain sitting in a long line of traffic. We most recently were able to put a temporary right turn lane at Union Hill Road to help relieve that traffic until the road gets under construction. Overlays. Placing of overlays in the District 3 has happened. We used to have a small one on Castleberry Road. It now covers all the main arteries in District 3 and some of the back roads as well. It has a minimal architectural design standard. It has four board fencing, and it requires additional plantings. All of these things will help have a more lay of the land that looks like it was planned out, which will help the values of all of our properties to increase. All of the intersection improvements along Post Road happen while I've been in office. There's five of them. That was crucial to the traffic moving a little bit. That is a state road, it's not even our road. We're still able to get that done. The 900-foot turn lane into Vickery Middle School, for those of you who had to travel and wait in line or on the edge of the creek, scared to death every time the car went by, it might bump you into the road. Excuse me, I thought I had that off. I'll let you control that. Just teasing. I'm sorry.
Bill
answered that. There it goes. All right. the 900-foot turn lane in finally, and I will tell you that is a godsend. With families sitting there and their children in the vehicles on the side of the road, there have been mirrors that have actually been taken off as cars gone by. So that was a struggle. It was the head of the safety of the BOE, Board of Education, that was begging the state for years to get it done. It wasn't happening. I finally stepped up. I was able to get enough votes on the board to get that funded. Unfortunately, we lost some battles. One of them was transparency. We do not, at this time, require all members of an LLC or have financial interest in LLCs to list themselves on zoning issues. The problem with that, as a commissioner, we sign paperwork saying that we have no conflict of interest. Without that being disclosed, there's no true way to show you have no conflict of interest. For me, it may be a bit easier. My family up here that lives in this county, or only two of us, me and my younger brother, I know what we own, that's easy. But for some commissioners that are large landowners and have family members of large landowners, it's extremely important that that's disclosed. They may or may not know that they have a conflict of interest. We, the public, have every right to know. Transparency in government is crucial at all levels, as a debate or Q&A like this helps create transparency, and that's why I'm here tonight. One of the strongest battles that I lost, unfortunately, was over the water and the withdrawal and trying to get an additional pipe into the river. That's going to be a struggle. We absolutely need to become water independent. We need to be able to have a secondary pipe that comes out of the lake. And if you read some of the Homeland Security paperwork, it recommends redundancy on things that require and required for human life support. That is absolutely human life support, is a water intake. If the cities fail to go back to throwing pumps in there and such like that, we should have an additional intake. They can have their intake. Should there ever be a failure from one or the other, we can share. It's easy to negotiate that kind of an item simply because you could go to the mayor on this instance and say, how much do you want? Because whatever you're going to charge, we're going to charge you. It's easy that way. Unfortunately, we don't have that. I tried again 2 years ago to go down to the EPD to increase our water permits based on the needs. The needs are exactly what the policy of the EPD says it should be based on, and they will change based on the municipality's needs. Well, our needs are greater than the city based on we service two-thirds of the county. They service one-third of the county. And it's real simple because in the contract that expired, it said that we would get back 5 million gallons a day as well. I brought all that down to the EPD, and they started to agree with me to the point that the director said, I will have you something in writing in 2 weeks. Unfortunately, we have a couple of commissioners that took the mayor in tow behind my meeting and killed the deal. We now pay on our water contract more for the permits that the city owns past the amount that we have. Because the permits we have do not fill our needs. We have to now buy water off of their permit as well, and they are charging us a higher rate on that water. So, and that is exactly why the EPD had it based on needs. So this couldn't happen in one municipality sticking to another just because the EPD decided to give them higher permits. I lost that vote, unfortunately. That's just the way it goes. I do know that David Hall is the pick of the city and is the pick of those two commissioners. They're supporting him. And it's crucial that you all vote for who best supports you. And by the way, that 11 million gallons a day on the river, that'd be brilliant for us. We're going to need that for our future. We really do. In our hot summer months, we will use between 18 to 24 million gallons a day, which starts to hit our max limit and the city limit that they can give us. We max out on use between the both municipalities. So it's crucial that we get the EPD to release that permit they've been trying to give us for years. It is. So some of these battles were close. They were 3-2 votes. They were back and forth. If anybody watching this meeting, they got a little rough sometimes. I've always stood with the people. I truly understand that I work with other elected officials. I don't serve them. I serve you, the people. And that is crucial that everybody understands it. There's a major difference in a political person that's in for politics and a person that's there as an elected official to serve the people. And I hope that you will vote for me. I hope you reelect me again. And I would love to give you another 4 years serving you. And now we'll let Ms. Claudia get to all her Q&A.
There you go. I thought you never know.
I had to.
So water obviously is a concern in how we get our water. Would you rate that as one of the three major challenges facing Forsyth County in the next 4 years?
It's going to be as part of the infrastructure, and it will be, like I stated, when we get in our hottest months and we're in a drought season, there's more water used and consumed by us. Even with the restrictions on not watering your car and your yards and stuff, it gets used up. We had as much as 24 million gallons a day last year, so it gets a little bit scary.
What would you rate as the other top two priorities for Forsyth County, and the top two concerns or challenges, and where would you, can you tell me how all three of them rate? So I'm looking for the top three. We know water is one of them. What are two other challenges the county faces, and where would you rank those?
The county government, as well, I'm on the BOC, has to deal with roads. We're doing a pretty good job on our roads. It's the state that we need to work with so diligently with. If you look at the roads that are backing up, causing our roads to back up, you'll find Post Road, you'll find Highway 9, you'll find Highway 20, Highway 400, you'll find 369 and 306, especially when they intersect. And that causes people to try to divert around those areas and get on our back secondary county roads, which then bottlenecks all of our county roads up. So it's crucial to work with them, get the structure of their roads in place, take care of the ones that we know we need to get done in our county, which we're very close to that. The other infrastructure issues I got to leave up to the BOE. It's going to be the BOE Board of Education, which is a separate government entity of the county. They have some catching up to do. With all the zonings that happened in the past and are now being built up so quickly, it is absolutely inundating our school systems. And they have starting to put in and starting to admit that they're meeting their capacities.
So I just want to follow up on two things. First off, road-wise, Highway 20, how much or how involved is the BOC getting or going to get with respect to the state's plans for maneuvering, moving a projected plan for a widening of 20, because you know that's, there was that whole project online and they asked citizens to go and
yes.
and let them know if they, you know, north was better, south was better, a flyover, a tunnel under, what would you prefer? Are you folks at the BOC level, are you talking about this already? And if not, do you think that Forsyth County should be taking a lead in the direction of how this should actually run?
Well, number one, I went to all those meetings and I put my input in. For me personally, and what I hear from the other BOC members and most people, they would like to see 20 stay on the road on the existing path it is now. Although we all know it needs to take a north and south path before it gets to the city of Cumming, possibly cutting across 306, and then there needs to be a south route. But when Bethel View gets completed by 2017, that should give us a south route. There is a group called the 20 Coalition, and they came to visit me, and they wanted my input, and they are on the same ideas as well. They don't want to see it cutting through the original path, what was once proposed as a outer perimeter. I have forwarded all of their information on my email list, about 5,500 emails, asking people to get involved. It's important that everybody understands what's going on and get involved, because once it happens, it's decided, it's too late. So many times I hear, I didn't know. Where was the information? So I try my best to send out emails whenever I can to inform people what's going on.
And I just had a follow-up to your statement about the Board of Ed and them playing catch-up. How closely does the BOC and the BOE, the Board of Commissioners and the Board of Education, how closely do you work together? And do you, if you're not working closely together, then how do you envision, or is there some manner, some process that you could propose to have you folks working more closely? Because I really think for the two of you to be operating like this, it does a disservice to the community.
It's actually dangerous.
It's dangerous.
If you don't have communications, what is developed by the commissioners needs to have a response from the BOA and the schools when they see us coming online. But the commissioners need to be very careful not to inundate them with such an influx of new homes and development that they can't keep up. That being said, if you look at most of these zonings are going now, like I said, there's a few back in 1990s, but most were from 2000, 2009. And we went through a lull, and there was a four-year window that they possibly could have tried to catch up. Unfortunately, that didn't happen. So now they realize that when this economy came back much quicker than people, once it started to come back, it was a slow comeback. And once it started to come back, it was a full running train. So I understand that they may be putting out for a vote this fall a $195 million bond in hopes that the public votes on it to build additional schools.
Do you think that a way to foment discussion would be for a process within the Board of Commissioners, the zoning, where perhaps an impact statement is attached to every application for an approval or rezoning, so that the BOC could then go back to the BOE and says, okay, well, we're getting ready to approve X, Y, and Z, and according to their impact statements, the school's going to be impacted like this, and like this. Is that in place already, or?
Not as well as it should have been.
Not as detailed?
No, and I absolutely agree that it needs to be. This is something Jim Boff and I have tried to put on the agenda, and the three commissioners took it off and reset and moved it away. With a state that has land rights under the Constitution, in order to decline some zoning from ag into some kind of a development or have a little more reasoning for making it extremely low density, it's these kind of things, or an engineer saying that the roads are overcrowded and can't handle it, that give us what we need legally to say no. So it's imperative that not only we get it from engineering when they say the roads are overcrowded and they can't handle it, that's to the point of a danger, and the BOE step up and say, here's our report, and in this area of the county right now, we can't handle any more growth. Please stop for X period of time.
Okay, so I'm gonna segue then into question number two, which is my second question that I was allowed to ask tonight because we had 15, but we've narrowed down. Number two on our list to ask you is, in what situation would you vote for a zoning when your planning staff has recommended a vote against?
Their recommendation comes at or around the application filing time. If a zone, the only time I would go and vote for is if the zoning applicant changes his request during the process so substantially that they would then approve it and they would then give a recommendation. And that does happen.
Okay.
For instance, if a res 4 gets put into an area, only res 2 and res 3 should be allowed, they will not recommend it. If the applicant then changes such a density in the zoning and brings it down to a res 2, then it does fit their criteria and is no longer something they would not give a recommendation for.
Okay, well that leads into, we've had instances and folks here who attend BOC meetings know exactly what I'm talking about, where the public is all prepared to speak on a rezoning and the plan that's been put forth by the developer, and everyone's gone around and done their homework and emailed you folks and done research on and all this, and they get to the BOC rezoning meeting and all of a sudden the developer stands up and says, well, we have another plan and this is the one that we wanna submit this one. Would you champion or would you be willing to work with your fellow commissioners to promote a change that wouldn't allow a zoning or a variance to go forward when the plans and drawings were not available to the voting body, you, and to the public less than 24 hours before the vote?
Absolutely agree with you. And in the past, you have seen where I have rescheduled and reset ones were up for scheduling, and I made them redo it and bring back a fresh set of plans. And for a 2-week period or more, and a matter of fact, I have one right now under Apex, we've done exactly that. When Casper Road is widened, there was a 33-acre tract and 11-acre tract being put together that they wanted to zone together. Within about a week or 10 days after the three commissioners voting to widen Casper Road to a 4-lane plus a turn lane, the 11 acres pulled out, and what we believe in hopes they think they can get commercial. I have postponed that now for them to redraw their plans and show it the way it's going to be today, so that there is time for government transparency and for everybody to do the plans.
All right, thank you. That's all I have for the moment. I think Jack was going to ask you some tough questions.
But this is regarding screen buffers and variances. This regards screen buffers and variances. As you know, that we have a stormwater management plan that addresses how buildings go up and how they're going to manage the stormwater and prevent erosion and contamination of our streams and waterways. Unfortunately, Forsyth County is very unique. It has a particular area that occupies a third of the county, the Big Creek Small Water Supply Watershed Overlay, which provides drinking water for Roswell. Some very important considerations in there. And in fact, there are areas of the county that, according to the Part 5 criteria map, it's an environmental criteria map put forth by the DNR, that states certain of the areas are more environmentally sensitive than others. Of course, we would like to see, my question to you is, would you support removing stream buffers from the variance process as a means of both protecting the existing county watershed and increasing green space, if not at least in those areas of environmental sensitivity, such as the aquifer recharge zones or groundwater recharge areas, wetlands, steep slopes, areas of increased pollution and susceptibility, areas of increased pollution susceptibility as identified upon the Forsyth County Part 5 environmental criteria map overlay.
And for those of you who don't know Mr. Gleason, he's serious about his water. And you know what, rightfully so. For those of you who don't totally understand it, there is a state law that speaks to or recommends 25%, no more 25% impervious areas when building. The ground acts as the best filter for water systems and pollutants and stuff like that. And water, obviously, is what we have to survive on. So Mr. Gleason is absolutely one of our county, if you want to say, a self-professed police officer that actually watches this for us. And I would tell you, a lot of times it's been a huge asset bringing some stuff to me, but I'm a hydrologist engineer. Commissioners vote on the zonings and we try to rely on our engineer department, that is. However, I would like to follow the rules that the state's followed and put forth. And even furthermore, I can't totally go with what Mr. Gleason says because every piece of land is created different. Some have different waters than others. Some we don't know about when we zone them, but our engineer department is supposed to go back out there no matter what the density was, no matter what amount of lots they were picked, and they're supposed to walk that land and find them all, state waters and all the sensitive waters that Mr. Gleason was speaking to. That typically always depletes the density. They lose lots because of this water. It's just the way it is. Our county has a more strict setback than the state. Or 75 feet instead of 50 feet that the state requires. We already held Mr. Gleason's interest in what he's looking to protect for us. So by stating that they lose lots and all, a lot of things Mr. Gleason is looking for are handled in that manner. Now I would tell you that our staff misses things from time to time as human beings. And Mr. Gleason has taken the time to go out there and point it out there and they have found additional items. For that I thank you. He takes a lot of time to do this. With that being said, if we were to stick with a closer number that actually holds us to the 25% impervious areas, we will start to accomplish some of the things you're looking for. But not all. I think that our staff needs to be more diligent to find all the areas that you're looking for because it forces them to move 75 feet outside those areas.
I think you might be misunderstanding though, there's that third of the county, that overlay is already delineated. And what I'm saying is, I'd like to see the buffers enforced with no possibility of a variance everywhere, but just because I'm into water quality and stuff.
Right, no, variances, I don't approve variances on that stuff.
Well, they apply, they appeal to you for them.
But
the consideration can be taken. It's within our rights of home rule to establish more stricter criteria if it's in the interest of our county.
Yes.
We have these areas of environmental sensitivity that are more environmentally sensitive and perhaps within that overlay that is depicted. And so if there's a clear red line around it, you could say, okay, in these areas here, don't bother asking for a variance because it's a protected watershed. These areas over here.
Well, I totally support that. I'm not interested in giving any variances around the watershed.
Right now, that impervious surface quotient is being ignored, blatantly ignored.
Right, and so just to follow up, so Smart Growth did a study, was that back in 2008? Sometimes I get my...
It was actually 2009 and 10.
We did a study on building in the Big Creek watershed area, and if you take a look at the map, the overlay map for how the watershed runs, it's a lot of District 3, and it comes down a little bit into District 2. It's more on the west side of 400, west southwest side.
Where the highest density is going.
Our study indicated that that we were at a certain level of impervious surface. The percentage was already, we were up at, I think, 13%. We did that without any real tools other than the GIS. And going back, each of us had a task. We had to go back to all the zonings within the watershed, and we had to calculate each zoning, how much had already been built. So we presented this report back to the county, and we said, okay, county, so 25% is your number. We estimate we're at 13. County
no, it's
went
22.
Back. No, just as it already built. Already built versus yet to be built. So we came 13% at already built. We went a step further. The county came back and said, I think they were within 1% of what we had. We were either 12 and they were 13 or vice versa. Within 1%, okay? We just went paper and pencil and did it that way. But we went a step further than the county and we said, okay, county, this is what you already have approved to be built within the watershed, X number of percent more. How are you going to keep track of all these things? And this was coming right into the crash. So a lot of stuff didn't get built. However, building is starting again, and in an attempt as well to perhaps direct or encourage development going into District 4, perhaps further north of 20, you know, we could say, well, you know what, we're just about reaching. We came up with a 22% count. If you were to build, if the county were to build, or not the county, developers were to build now in the Big Creek watershed, everything that's been approved, that number already shot up to 22%. County never came back. They're not tracking what's being actually built, how much surface
if you is if you want water. My opinion, I think it should be tracked. The simple reason is this: in addition to the concerns of the water quality, you're going to have people that own land that believe land rights, but what they got to be careful of, if they allow everybody to build and build too much density, that by the time it gets to their land being sold, we would have hit the limits that you're speaking of. And the state could say no more building count. They could pull the plug, and those landowners could be stuck never being able to sell or develop for land, sell land for development. So it's, their plan makes it also fair for all landowners and spread it out more evenly. But the state could do that. They have a rule. They absolutely could.
I took your number 6, Jack.
Oh, I got the next one too.
Yeah, I took it already.
Okay, well, that related to that directly is, will you then champion a Big Creek watershed impervious surface management plan that will include the following: county tracking of the current impervious surface percentage in the watershed, county tracking of approved but not yet built estimated impervious surface percentage in the watershed, county tracking of the total estimate, that's the current plus approved but not yet built impervious surface percentage in that watershed, and county initiated incentive plan, which would be a tax break or a land bank or green space to study, some motive to encourage that, and for landowners and developers to remain at or below the state mandated 25% impervious surface percentage. And actually, I think you answered all that in your remarks.
Yeah, you know, it's some people think when you impose these rules on them that you're getting into their land rights. But the truth of the matter is, if you look at the quality control, it looks after all of us. And if you pay attention to this and plan this in the future, it also looks after larger landowners as well in the future. They still have the ability to develop and sell their land. I think it's beneficial to everybody to pay attention. And it doesn't take that much. A Res 2 zoning or a low density Res 3 zoning falls in this category, totally qualifies. It doesn't get into or breaks these numbers. So it's not hard to meet these numbers. It's the Res 4s and 6s and all these things, and large shopping centers that are all paved and don't have to have enough green space to eat up into this bank, if you will, that they're speaking to.
You can just look at Big Creek, and every time it rains, it doesn't have to be
a
2-inch rain. It can be a flood. It floods all the time.
The Greenway floods with half an inch of rain. We have half an inch of rain in an hour, and they have to close it down.
Yeah, I don't totally agree with that. We actually cleaned out the creek some, so it flows a little better now. Had a lot of debris in there.
Well, good for you.
But yes.
Right there.
We're going to switch gears now, and Bill's got the next question for you, coming away from the impervious surface.
Mr. Plant, obviously we need to encourage commercial and some residential growth, okay, to keep our millage rate down. What kind of specific businesses should we attract to the county? Now that, we're talking smart growth businesses, we're talking energy efficient businesses, quality businesses that, that we can encourage through the Chamber of Commerce or through, through our efforts, other organization efforts, through the commissioners. What kind of smart growth can we attract?
Technology is absolutely number one, and we have been doing that. That's why the unemployment rate's gotten down to 5% and going down more, dropping. Technology is typically small parts that have a big value to them, and they pay more to the employees. It's a higher pay rate typically, which allows somebody to buy a little bit more expensive house. And with that, it helps not raise mill rates as well. These things also have to be done by technology because we don't have a railroad here. These little parts that are expensive can be transported on trucks, which is our main source of transportation here. So that's what we have been shooting for, that's what we have been doing. More recently, there's been a company that's come in that I worked with about 9 months ago. They have a meter reading system for power companies. And when there's a surge or there's a break in a line, they have these meters periodically and starts to break it down immediately where it is so that electricity is not wasted. And it immediately notifies the whether Georgia Power or Sony EMC, and they're taking off like a rocket right now, supplying people around the country, and they're right here in our county. So very excited about that.
A corollary on this is obviously we went through a recession. Have a lot of commercial strip shopping centers that are not fully occupied right now. Would you encourage, as part of the smart growth, that we find a way to attract commercial customers to take existing space and fill up, occupy, or at least raise the occupancy rather than clear cutting, putting new strip shopping centers?
I understand where you're coming from. One of the best ways to do that is certainly they rely on rooftops, people to shop at their stores before they open up and make sure they're going to be in business. But I encourage everybody here and everybody around the county, before you head to Milton or Johns Creek or down to Sandy Springs or even to Dawsonville to shop, try to find your product here first. Not only does that help us keep our stores filled, but it's huge in our tax base. If you count the first four cents of the 7 cent sales tax goes to the state, but the number five goes into our general fund and brings in somewhere around not quite, but it could be about 40%, give or take, of our total overall general fund budget. So it's huge when it puts into the account. Number six goes to the schools. So every time you spend money here, you help support these things where they don't have to ask for extra bond money. Number seven goes into your SPLOST, which is your capital improvements to the county, whether it's the library, whether it's the courthouse, whether it's the jail, whether it's roads and bridges here. So every time you spend here, it helps in all kinds of ways, including filling those spaces. Okay, and also, I got to tell you, I opened up a retail store about 10 months ago, so I helped that situation.
You mean existing?
Yeah, the space was coming empty, I took it.
That's good.
Yeah.
The next question deals with the Unified Development Code. Do you feel the county Unified Development Code is too restrictive or too liberal with regard to development, and how so? Do you feel that code enforcement, including the UDC and overlays, we have the Peace Street Parkway overlay, we have the Castleberry overlay, those are the two only existing, I believe, isn't that correct? There's one more?
This is right. This is where I went on your question.
Okay. If not, what additional enforcement provisions or fines would you propose? If commercial establishments are not conforming to the UDC, or they're asking for variances from the UDC?
Well, first off, the UDC is a great base start, it is. I absolutely believe in overlays, and there should be ones in different areas to create a character for each area. This is absolutely raised property values, and I was speaking to one earlier that I finally got done in District 3, and I got all five votes for it. It took a while to get everybody on board with it. So you've got it on Highway 9. It's going to be on Mullinex before it gets widened. It's already in place. It goes down Bethelview, it goes down Post Road, and there's a lighter version of it that goes down Shiloh, Campground Road, and so another one of the back roads. But all of it tries to build some continuity where things flow, look like they go together. If you go into different towns that have, where they have themes, or they have certain areas that do certain ways, and it's always very attractive for people, and they pick which area most suits their needs. I don't want to say everything needs to be the same everywhere through the county, because America, we like to choose what we like. You like to be able to pick and choose whether or not somebody wants a small lot. There's some people don't want to cut grass. So it's all about the density over that, let's say, 100 acres of land. As long as the density isn't a high density, it's a low density, and they choose to have walking trails within their green space, or the guy that chooses not to have the walking trails would rather bigger lot himself to put a pool in his backyard. There's different people who want different things. It's all about the density for me. So with that, I think our UDC has some flexibility in there. I would like to see us get back to where we can get more flexibility. We have a minimum lot size and an average in the same zoning. So that developer may go in and do a couple of different plans of lots so people could choose what best suits their needs and their liking, but yet the density is still a reasonable density. If somebody violates and steps over the line and breaks the rules, code enforcement needs to go do what they need to do. And they do all the time. They stop them until they comply. That's just what they do.
Along those same lines, developers have historically in certain areas been warned in writing numerous times, and yet no collection been made, there's been no stop order. So code enforcement is somewhat lacking. The rules are there and they're violating the rules.
A commissioner does not get into employment. We're not allowed to. We set policies, set the rules and such, we set budgets. If code enforcement not doing the job, that's going to be something for the county manager to address. And he goes down to the chain of command to get that done. I do understand that they will put stop work orders on until they can comply. If they write a citation, that fine is up to the judge. It's out of our hands. So the judge needs to decide whether or not he's going to place a fine on them and for how much. And of course, there's a maximum on a county ordinance as well.
Can the Board of Commissioners take a position with the county manager or with a particular developer and say,
well, you don't
we
want,
recommend?
We don't, no, not, you can to an extent, but you don't want to start selectively enforcing a certain developer.
Well, just generally speaking.
We could tell the county manager, hey, look, will you sit down and make sure they're doing and enforcing the laws that are on the books? We can't do that.
Respectfully, Commissioner, we have an alcohol ordinance, and it's the Board of Commissioners that ultimately those people who violate the alcohol ordinance that go before, and they're subject to your discretion.
But we don't do the fines. The courts do the fines first. They got to go through the courts first.
Okay.
If they're found guilty, then they come to us.
Sure.
If they're released, they don't even come to us.
But they're permitted, and their ability to do business in the county, that's the same thing. And all this relates to level of service.
And we suspend licenses, we suspend their permits.
Okay.
I've even taken one completely from somebody before, because they violated so much, so
right.
Yes.
Well, right now, a violation of screen buffers is some $250 fine if they get caught. If that was changed to a $25,000 fine, you can bet that they'd be
a little more careful.
What is the maximum on that, Mr. Gleason? Mm-hmm. What's the maximum allowed the court can apply?
Actually, my understanding is it's $2,000 a day once you've been notified that there's a violation. That's a state law.
Okay,
the county can be as stringent or more stringent.
Like I was saying, we don't decide what the ultimate fine is going to be. It's already, apparently you're saying there's a fine. has stated greater than the 250, but we're not the entity that decides ultimate fine. We just put the policies in.
Respectfully, sir, home rule predicates that you can choose to. Our argument, my argument, individually, the concerned citizen is that it's being ignored versus enforced.
I understand. And like you said, it's actually added $2,000 or greater price, but yet they're only implementing a 250. It's not us that, it's not, now you know that there's fines for silt and silt fence being down and things like that that hit $50,000 and $100,000 plus that people have been hit with.
Right.
So they do get some pretty stiff fines for things that mess with the water system.
And I would not admonish, but I admire the county stepping forward and giving offer relief to those developers who stepped up and pick up those pipe farms that we call them. And gave them some relief for some of those because the developers, nothing's happening.
Thanks, Jack. Appreciate it. We're going to turn it over to Dean now, who's going to go continue on with that, with the zones
you got,
and
you got one, number,
I've got it. Sorry.
Number four?
Sorry,
did you already get that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So we're going to go Dean with what was.
when you guys paying hold questions?
We're not. Go ahead, Dean.
We already did.
Will you jump in no longer allowing the inclusion of mandatory setbacks and buffers, such as riparian buffers, the open space calculation for the various zoning categories, or as an alternative, will you champion changing the open space requirements to a flat 60% open space requirements for all zoning categories, which will allow the developer owner to count all mandatory setbacks, buffers, and other non-buildable land in the calculation for open space?
For people that don't keep up with what you're talking about, you might want for the public to be a little more layman's term with your question, because you're going to lose them. Basically, what I think he's asking is, will we increase the buffers and not allow them to include the creeks and waters and such like that into the buffers?
No, well, it's actually when you do it, when a rezoning comes forth or a zoning, so everything, even the non-buildable land, is
correct.
Included
That's correct.
In how you get to calculate the final density.
That's correct.
So you have a lot of 100 acres, and you're including all 100 acres, even though maybe 40 acres of that 100 acres is wetland, stream, non-buildable, but currently those 40 acres are included in the calculations for density. So if you took that 40 out and said, okay, well, here's a 100 acre lot, you've got 40 acres you can't build on because of whatever between the buffers and the wetland and all, so your actual buildable land is 60 acres, and from there you calculate the density.
Of the overall land.
Of only the 60 acres.
They're asking to only include the 60 acres.
Yes, we only want the 60, we want the rest is not buildable, so it shouldn't be included.
This is going to be a very good question. I have a huge, it's going to be a long answer.
Okay. I'm going to add more.
Yes, and here's the reason being. When a person owns a piece of land for a long, long period of time, this could be a double answer because I think that it depends on how this comes out. That person is paid on that land, let's say for 50 years, they've paid taxes. They paid the county and they paid the state their taxes for that property. They were charged on the land as a value to that land, even the portions that Claudia has mentioned. So is it right to then tell them they can't calculate it, or is it easier to just have a lower density and not let them pack everything into the buildable area, accomplishing the same thing? Because if you just tell somebody, you know what, your land, that 40%, is completely useless, so we're not going to allow you to calculate at all, they're going to say, I've been paying taxes on that for 50 years, and you charged me a value of my land all those years. So It's a double-edged sword there. So when you calculate it, and I have one coming up just to tell you how I'll stand on this one. There's one coming up where they bought a very small piece of land, all buildable. They're adding, I believe, it's 20 acres of pure wetlands next to it to try to calculate their green space. In that case, absolutely they do not support it. in my opinion, they're manipulating the spirit of the way UC was written in order to accomplish exactly what you're saying is not right. And in that case, I wouldn't support it at all. It's not right. But a man that's owned or a woman that's owned their land their entire life, I still don't want to have any density on it. And we've charged them for a value on that land. How can you tell them there's no value whatsoever and you can't use it? It just doesn't seem right. It seems like they'd be having a challenge in court. So, but I don't say you give them res 4 or res 6 in the buildable part and then start calculating that either. I still say you keep a moderate and reasonable density on the land that'll still accomplish what you're trying to accomplish or close to it. That makes sense.
Makes sense.
Well, the only problem with that is the particular impact it's going to have, the buildable height.
Keep the density low.
No matter what resident, no matter what zoning you choose for the buildable land, you've increased the impervious surface. You've impacted on stream buffers.
As long as you keep the density low, you have not. Remember, I said you got to have the density has to be a reasonable density, so it doesn't happen. That's all.
So you will take into account the non-buildable land and the residents.
The state constitution, you make a challenge. You've charged a person for that land their whole life as a value. And now you tell them there's no value. Wouldn't it be easier to accomplish the same thing by having a reasonable density on the buildable land? And you've almost accomplished the same thing.
But maybe there would be a way to incentivize.
I would agree with that then.
Where they're going to end up losing that 40 acres or their perceived value, because technically there's the value is just what it is. They have their home on it and they've got their 99 extra acres and that's it. The value goes up when they have somebody sniffing around wanting to put 600 homes on 100 acres.
And that's why I said you're reasonable with your density on the
buildable
side.
As long as you're reasonable
side.
With it,
yes.
That's fine.
Yes.
I have
a follow-up argument.
I'm on it. I'm on a roll. I have actually two questions for you, and then we're going to turn it over to the folks in the audience. The first question is, will you support a return to district-wide voting, or would you, that's a good question.
That's about an hour debate, believe it or not. There's a lot of pros and cons to it. And the reason why she's asked this question, for those of you who don't know, if a commissioner is constantly voting for things in your district that you don't like and he's not your district commissioner, you can't reach out and touch them with your vote. Very dangerous for us. And sometimes they do things they probably wouldn't have done otherwise if you could have reached out and touched them. And this, in my opinion, also works with the IGAs, the intergovernmental agreements with the city. You can't reach out and touch them. Well, you probably should. And another one is, there were 700 apartments put in District 3, and I was the only one that voted against. I'm not into 700 apartments in one location, makes no sense. It's almost nuts is what it is. In fact, my voting record shows I voted against apartments more than any of the commissioner, for those that actually looked the record up and not look at the flyer that ended up in the mail lying about me. But I would support different concepts. I definitely think the chairman needs to be at large. He should be a countywide person for a lot of reasons. One reason was when the commissioners appoint him, it causes a little bit of contention, see, on the board. Another reason, you've got another person you could reach countywide, and you might be able to turn that vote a little bit by putting pressure with emails. I have seen 400 emails hit our website, and half the commissioner, three of the commissioners completely ignored every one of them because they weren't the massum from their district, which is kind of dangerous. So possibly two or three by district and the rest at large, or three or four by district and one at large or two at large. Something needs to change though, I wasn't.
Or maybe based on the population increasing, because I think the projection is that we're gonna get to, 360 or so, yeah. And then beyond that up to 600,000. Yeah. I mean, I don't know that five commissioners is all that have, maybe five commissioners per, one per district, and two at large.
We argue enough as it is.
You're right. And on that, I want to close. I'll
fill it in because this one. As the population grows, the census is done every 10 years. By law, our maps have to change to adjust population to try to balance it even out. And that happened from the 2010 census, we changed it in 2011.
Did you have one that you think that I'm missing?
No.
I wanted to...
Number 15, right?
Yeah, we started with what are the three major challenges facing Forsyth County? And I'd like to ask you, what are the three major challenges facing your district, District 3, in the next 4 years, and where do you stand?
It's going to be the growth. We are receiving the mass majority of all zoning applications at this time. It's the south part of the county where a lot of people want to live, with the southwest corner, if you will, and there's a lot of green land still. So the challenge is going to be not getting outvoted and trying to make sense of the zonings, so that our future makes sense, not just 20 years in advance, but 50 plus even for our children if they choose to stay here. That's my biggest challenge, is trying to get the consensus of the board to follow what we want from this district and go along with what we believe is right for our district and not outvote us all the time. Big challenge.
Thank you for that. What I'd like to do now is open it up to the raffle ticket holders. And Susan's going to come up with the tickets. Go ahead, Bill. Just pull one out. If your number is called and you have a question for your candidate for commission, please stand up, state your name, and ask your question. This is your forum. This is your opportunity to meet your candidate up close and personal.
Okay. It's probably just the last three digits. 380. 619-380.
I was probably tomorrow when you just walked out.
What's that? I don't know. Go ahead,
then go to the next one. All right. If you're not 380, then we'll go to the next one.
Trying to find a tough one for you this weekend. Okay. 375. Okay, sir.
My name is Matt Henderson. I live in the Westbrook neighborhood in District 3. There is a push right now, or some interest in communication going on about the formation of a new town in the county. Has there ever been, to your knowledge, or how far along has that discussion ever gone before? And if that does come to pass, how will that affect county politics? With right now, it's always just been coming. The entire county is coming.
That's a good question. We have quite the struggle with the negotiations of the loss and SPLOST splits and other things with IGAs right now in the city of Cumming. I don't understand the need for another city. It creates another government, it creates additional tax for those people within that district. And it's the Sharon Springs where I believe you're talking about. And I asked the people, because I had a meeting, they called a meeting with me to see what I thought about it. My question then was, why? Why do you feel it's so important to do it? I understand why they did it in Fulton County, because they felt they're paying so much taxes into the system and all that money is being sent down and they were getting taxed without representation and they weren't getting their infrastructure back for the money they're putting in the pot. And their answer to me was zonings. I said, well, if you just elect a commissioner better represents you, wouldn't that be easier? And not create all the extra tax, because even if you create another city, you're still going to have to elect additional officials. And where's the guarantee they're going to do anything better for you? Work hard, put that time and money in getting the right official for you now. And then you don't have all the extra taxes to go with it. It just doesn't make a lot of sense to me.
Thank you.
And I would ask everybody, ask the question, please stand up and speak clearly, like you did. 364.
No questions?
Okay.
Is it possible to ask, if you don't have a ticket, to ask a follow-up question?
Yes, would you like to ask a follow-up? Sure. What's your name?
Jim.
Jim, come up here where we can hear.
I'm from Jim Bob's area.
So is Bill on this question?
Yeah, it was stated just prior to his question, as I understood it, I'm a newbie in all this. My question is, you said if we elected a solid representative of our area, but it goes back to the previous conversation where that's only one vote on the Board of Commissioners. And as you stated, again, as a newbie, I've seen a lot of 3-2 votes. So I'm not for a new city. They also approached me, a couple of these folks, and explained zoning. And based upon the way the situation is now, where they can vote
on our situation, but we can't vote on them?
Yep.
It's not fair representation.
It's not fair representation.
So as far as the motivation for a Sharon Springs Incorporated city, right now the way it says, it makes a lot of sense to me.
Because you'll be able to vote and touch everybody. So why don't we push for countywide voting for commissioners?
Absolutely.
Not create you guys an extra tax.
Absolutely.
And right now, if you've looked at most of the things I believe you guys are desiring down there, Jim Boff and myself have been voting with you all on, I believe, every issue.
I could.
And if you had your commissioner doing the same, you had your three votes you needed also. Yeah. But it is important that we all realize and get with your state delegates and decide how you want it to be done. Vote by district, vote by countywide for your commissioner, and push them to put it back on the ballot again so you can vote on it again. Now, the people did vote to put it where it is today. I don't think they understood the ramifications of it.
So people voted to put it in as
I think it was just was it a vote, or was it just they put it on the ballot as a binding, or just to see what the interest level was?
To see. And the people voted in majority for it.
And can I ask one more question?
No.
The word of reason.
Thank you. Okay. 366.
That's me.
There you go.
I really don't have any questions, but I will say this. I'm disappointed that David Holt didn't show up, because I was going to have... I'm sorry, I'm Bonnie Orenstein. And I live in Sheffield Subdivision. And I was going to ask David what it was he felt as though he would have done differently that you did specifically, and why. So I guess I'll change that to say, how do you feel you've done so far, and what would you do differently, you know, based on what you know now that you didn't know when you first started?
Great question.
It is a great question. Thank you. The bottom line is this. I have created an email list as big as I possibly can. I encourage everybody to get on it. The more contact I have with the people, the more ability I have to find out what the will of the people is. My vote, people ask me, what's your agenda, Mr. Levent? And they say, don't think you have an agenda. I said, my agenda is to serve the people. It will change as the people tell me to change it. So what I will do different is whatever you tell me to do different. As long as I believe it's the mass will of the people, as my oath states.
And I would just suggest that you contact Mr. Hole, either through his website, or he has a phone number published on there, and ask him, of course he said, you know, ask me any questions on my email or by phone, and ask him, what does he think?
What does it take for us to force him and Todd to meet together and have a debate? Dates don't matter.
I would like to be on a public forum rather than just a simple...
Well, unfortunately, there's been several groups that have tried to get together. I've put my calendar aside for everything except for the dates that were county meetings where I have to be at the county meeting. And he has not accepted one today. I'm hearing that he said there's not enough time. And I beg the question, when we have time to sit down for an hour and a half, how in the world are you going to find the 30 to 40 hours a week to be a commissioner?
Exactly.
And service the way you need to.
And maybe in the end, that's all you really need to know. Right?
Okay, next question. Number 371. There he goes. Nope.
No.
371.
Okay. Move along so we can get a initial copy of Phillips.
Okay, 378.
I'd like to ask a question on a bit higher level. You know, you're getting old commissioners are getting inundated with all these zoning questions and board usage and detailed questions. Somehow, I expect you to be, and your fellow commissioners, to be the leaders in this community, to have a plan, a land use plan, an economic growth plan, a schools plan, everything that integrates into a master plan. And you should have the courage and the leadership to stand up and say, we're going forward with this plan, and if, you know, if your fellow commissioners are against it, you've got to be able to stand up and fight them and make sure that we understand what they're saying and what they're voting against, so that we can support you.
Yes, sir. Tune into our meetings. They are televised, and you can also get them online, and you'll see that I do exactly what you've asked. We do have a plan. It's an overlay map, and it gives a plan. We have to update it every 10 years, and it gives pretty good guidelines of what should go in what areas for growth. And it is a plan. Now, the BOE, the Board of Education, is a separate government from us. We can only hope they keep up with the schools, or that we slow down growth enough to allow them to catch up to us.
I'm not sure all your fellow commissioners are bought into that economic model that says we need schools.
I keep hearing
this Fayette County BS, which, you know, yes, that's one special county that had one industry.
Yes,
industry had failed, so yeah, they
go
good. But that's not a good example to you.
I agree with you completely. I've read multiple speeches, and I've stood for all kinds of things and brought things up to change things. As we see the growth going too fast, we have a better plan. And I put it on the agenda with another commissioner, two people, to put it on an agenda item. The three commissioners keep taking it off and moving it out. They don't want to discuss it. So if you watch the meetings, you would see that, unfortunately. Those three are supporting David Hull against me, because I bring it up too much.
Can I ask a follow-up?
Yes, ma'am.
Stand up, please.
What can we do if we aren't in those districts and those commissioners keep pushing it out for a vote?
Do you have any friends in those districts?
Probably.
Do you have a Facebook page in that district?
Oh, yeah.
Well, you can go and place that agenda item off the agenda, see what happened, explain it to them, and enlighten them and bring them up to date so they can vote in your behalf.
And there are a number of community organizations that have kind of blossomed this past really doing crazy development search that's occurred since, I would say, spring of last year, actually the last year, the whole kind of development is on crack. Everybody wants a piece of it and wants it now. So the community groups that have sprung up are fixed for site traffic. They have a Facebook presence and I believe a website. For site HOA homeowners, they have a very large Facebook presence and a website. Post Road Citizens for Proper Development, they have a Facebook page.
Responsible Growth.
And then for site citizens for Responsible Growth, they also have a Facebook page. And so each of these groups.
And then Smart Growth.
And then, of course, Smart Growth, they call us the godfather. But because only because we've been around for this amount of time. But all these groups have either sprung from issues that have, you know, a lot of people say, oh, you're just a NIMBY group, you know, not in my backyard. That's the kind of group you are. And actually, we're not. And I think that citizens that get up and take an active role in how their particular neck of the woods is going to develop, they're not NIMBYs. They are protecting their property values and protecting the quality of their schools and protecting, in turn, the quality of their life. And that, in turn, protects the quality of life for all Forsyth Countyans. You know, this is not a North versus South battle, District 2 versus District 4 versus 3 versus 1. It doesn't work like that, because when the county succeeds and when the county does the right things right and we are moved off of a fifth fastest growing to number one best place to live list, that's the list we want to be on, right? We want to be on the fastest growing. We want to be on Is this the best place in the country to live?
Sir, you live in District 2, is that correct?
We do.
Yes.
Or 5. I believe this is Forsyth HOA.
HOA homes, yeah.
You may want to join the group that will keep you up to date.
My question would be, you know, I realize all these groups are working somewhat on parallel paths. Are they coordinated? Do they have a strategy? Can they, you know, help Mr. Levent? Are we doing anything?
To a certain degree, we are coordinated. We communicate.
We communicate
with them. We know what interests they have. Some of them can be partisan, whereas we're not partisan.
We're not political.
We're not political.
We consider these types of forums to be an educational service to the community, but we as a group, Smart Growth, will not come out and endorse a specific candidate. We can't do that.
Let me just mention one thing, Ian, to your question. There is a comprehensive plan for the county. There were public meetings. There was input. There were questions and responses.
It was in a different climate. It was in a different environment. 2008
exactly.
Is totally
exactly.
Different.
It was.
I agree with you completely. Sorry.
It needs to be redone. Right. Okay. Okay, let's go on to the next question. 361. There you go, sir.
Well, I've never won a lottery. Yeah. I'm Robert Chambers with the Highway 20 Coalition. My question has been answered, but I want to thank the commissioner for meeting with us, taking time, and I want to thank the commission for agreeing that we need to keep 20 on 20, and we do not need a new $3 billion freeway coming through our county, so I want to thank you for that. I did bring our position statement. I'll put it on the back table. If anybody has questions afterwards, I will be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Thank you. 368. No 368. Okay.
Jeff Trump.
If we have time. 373. Somebody 373.
Oh,
there you go. I might get to you.
Jesse Kirkland, Fox Creek. My question is about paying of the road. So I heard this story about we don't have the funds within the state to fund some of the roads. So we're taking care of that, and you got that passed within the county. What, if anything, as far as partnership with the states to either pay that money back to us, because essentially we've funded roads that they should be paying for, right? And then going forward to negotiate for the state to pay for the roads that they should be maintaining and improving.
You're a man after my heart. All right, so we've been down, we go down to the DOT headquarters, at least we've done it here. The whole board of commissioners goes down there, and we have these Q&A that you just touched on. And they tell us there's no money. They tell us that the only jurisdictions right now that are getting anything moving forward are putting in a fair chunk of change to get all of the studies done. If any federal money is involved, those studies take 3 to 5 years. When they tell us there's no money for Post Road and it's really jamming up bad, and some of the money is lost or designated as emergency funding or improvements along a certain corridor area, I'm happy that we're able to get it done for the people. I can't imagine what they'd be in now without those left turn lanes and intersection improvements on Post Road today. We do get some back to the state in that aspect. I'm not going to totally throw them under the bus. They were taking over Bethelview Road and paying a large chunk of that. Large chunk of that was our road. We have now turned it over to them through the construction process. But does that balance out what we need? No, it does not. It's a great help, though. Now, Highway 9 should have been done 12 to 15 years ago. Highway 20 should have been 10 to 12, 15 years ago. Sometimes that stuff gets political. Sometimes we're a very strong Republican county. When you have a Democrat governor in office, you're not going to get much, unfortunately.
Oh, don't blame it on the Democrats.
Yes, Claudia is.
Right.
We still love each other.
I'm Alexander. We're sitting at the same
table. No, but I wasn't bashing you. That's just facts. And if it works the other way around, it would work the other way around. It just does. And it's unfortunate that it does. Here's a real sticker to it, which is very interesting and needs to be changed. When you pay for your gas, there's a large chunk of that goes in taxes. It goes to the federal government. The state officials tell me they get approximately 95% of that back, and it comes with certain strings, ADA compliant sidewalks and all kinds of other things. And the environmental impact studies that take 3+ years. That money then comes back to the jurisdictions by 14 different congressional districts. They do them and they split it evenly and not based on what we pay in. And that to me is wrong. If you're in a rural part of the state that doesn't pay much tax and doesn't have a lot of vehicles on the road, why are they getting equal proportion? We're paying so much taxes in, they're getting a lot of our money and they don't really need it, but we do. We don't get it back. So the state really needs to change that rule where it gets paid back somehow tracking based on how much was paid in, and that's easy to tell by how much use you're on the road, because you're paying it by taxes on your gas that you pump in your vehicle.
By need.
So that's something you need to push your state delegates to help us with getting changed. That is huge. And by the way, there's a gentleman in the back. I think Mike Williams is running for state senate that has promised me he would work on that.
100%. My name is Ed Kroll. I live in the Sheffield subdivision down off Campground Road. You have on your little flyer here that you voted against giving the city 15% of the local option sales tax. Can you explain to me why we even vote on that? Doesn't the state dictate?
No, when you have a city within the county, or multiple cities within the county, you have to come up with a split, and it gets really complicated, and if it's worded something like this, you should, not shall, should consider 8 criteria. And those criteria list out with services that each other offer each other or supply to one another, or you offer or supply to your citizens. Now, number one, their population at the time of that vote was about 3.2%, and the county's the rest. So some people will say, well, let's just give 3.2%. And then you have to calculate things in there like fire services. Well, we give them the fire services, yes, but they also pay for it because they have to pay the same fire millage we do. They do pay a county tax. They don't pay a city tax. And that's where it gets problematic. If you give them too much split on loss, they're allowed to put that in the general fund. If you pay them too much for water, they're allowed to put that in the general fund. And are they allowed to then live off us in the county and not have to have a city tax? And are we being taxed without representation? And I don't stand for that. And that's where the problem comes in. And I think that you'll find that to be a clear difference between Mr. Hole, because the two commissioners that support him also support the city. In fact, one of those commissioners filed legal action against the county on behalf of the city of Cumming over these taxes.
A commissioner did?
A commissioner that now sits in the Board of Commissioners. At the time, he was not a commissioner.
Who is that commissioner?
And he supports David Holt, so there you have it. It makes the votes easier for them to get.
Why do they support it?
Why do they support what?
Why do they support it?
They're looking for that third vote and to shut me up because I speak very loud.
So someone that aligns with their
thoughts. I speak very loud for the people that I represent. I mean, it made front page news from one week to the other, calling the mayor out when I felt he wasn't telling the truth. And I came back with pure documentation and a PowerPoint presentation to show it. And then I was front page news saying, it's not true, Mr. Mayor. And they would love to shut me up. But.
The last question.
Okay.
We'll make it good. 363. There you go.
My name is Sandy Dickerhoff. I live on the southwest side of Forsyth County. I do have one brief question before I ask my real question. How long have you lived in the county?
Approximately 24 years.
Okay. So I don't look at that as a benefit, in my opinion, as being new to the state of Georgia and the county. Not newish, 5 years. But I want to know what the difference is between an old-timer, long-time landowner and a developer who buys two adjacent lots when it comes to the zoning approval. Tax payments, past tax payments, I don't feel should be taken into account. I think that's an old way of doing business, and to people, I think that the growth in Forsyth County comes from outside the county, outside the state. You look at any of these new developments, that's where people are coming from. And I think that seems like a conflict of interest to me. So I'd like to know your opinion on that.
I hope I answered your question correctly, your comments. The only person that can ask for zoning on a land is a landowner. They sign up an affidavit to whoever the applicant's going to be on their behalf, whether it's a law firm, whether it's a developer that's going to hire a law firm, or whether they're going to represent themselves in the application. So there is no real difference, you're correct. But the state constitution speaks to their rights to their land and whether or not you cannot force them to keep it agricultural. You have to give them some kind of land use, and then it speaks to another phrase of highest and best use. So you're right, you can't discriminate by who owns it or not, but you'll find most landowners are not the ones bringing applications forward. They have somebody that's knocked on their door, have interest in developing their land, and they typically have hired, not always, but they typically have hired a law firm to represent them.
I think it's safe to say that those people benefit, no matter what. Whether they own land for 20 years.
They're in business to make money.
Right, right, and they've owned that, and they've held that land. They could have sold that land 10 years ago when Forsyth County started moving, but they chose to hold, you know.
Well,
you either get out of the game or you stay in.
And I think everybody's reason for holding their land's got to be different. Some people may be in their 40s. They're not ready to let it go yet until they're ready to retire. For some people, it's actually their stock market. For some people, it was inheritance from their great-grandfather who they loved, and they just don't want to let it go. And they've gotten to the point they can't afford the taxes now, and they're looking now to not lose it. So now they have to find somebody to buy it and get them free from it, and they want to go into retirement. There's so many different reasons why people decide when the right time is for them. In America, you're allowed to do that. So I don't think any one reason has the same reasons, typically.
I think the problem goes back to what you discussed about, what the Smart Growth-Forsyth people discussed, is that when you have non-buildable land, whether someone buys two adjacent lots or whether someone owns that land, I think that that's the route that we have to go through. I think that that's what we need to move towards, is that you could have rivers and streams and woods on your land that's not buildable, and zone it R5, and we're all screwed.
I agree with you. And obviously, no matter what you zone it, they still have rules they can't get near that water. And our rules keep them further off the water than the actual state mandates us to. And like Mr. Gleason said, you can be more restrictive than we are. So I still don't think, if somebody has a lot of water and a lot of land, I don't want to throw heavy density on the part that's buildable. Still, I agree with you, that makes sense. You have to use sensibility for all kinds of reasons. You have to weigh and balance your infrastructure, all infrastructure, whether it's water, schools, roads. You have to take in consideration how it's going to impact other people around there, how it's going to affect their quality of life. The land rights speak to not just large landowners. It speaks to you and I that may have just half acre acre lot too. We're also landowners. And you can't allow that landowner to encroach on your quality of life. There's a balance has to be found.
There's means of compromise here. I'm a big adherent of the fact that there should be a compromise that would be reasonable to developers and a reasonable to homeowners. But as homeowners, we have to keep the pressure on our planning commission, our zoning board, our board of commissioners, and we have to be reasonable and fair and say, this is the way we want the direction of Forsyth County to go. So let's work all together in that area. I'd like to thank Commissioner Levent for coming tonight. You're taking time out on Monday evening to come out, ask questions, listen, and listen to what Commissioner Levent has to say. We have coffee, we have Gatorade, we've got water, there's decaf coffee, and donuts and cookies. Please share in the next few minutes we've got. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
I live in the north part of the county off of 361.
Wow.
Are you there now?
Yes, sir.
Excuse my language, but that is a thing.